give him a round of a warm welcome to Mario Belling.
Okay, so hello. So I'm Mario. We started FOSS Asia 10 years ago. I'm originally from Germany, but I feel like home on this planet. Yeah, I'm always here and there, and and that's why I just feel so natural to work also together with UNESCO, right? So we have a lot of people with like an international background. Living in Thailand, coming from Europe, being in Asia and so on. So that was one thing. I was living in Vietnam 10 years ago. We had a company there, and at that time, a lot of European companies moved to Asia. Yeah, for example, they started software outsourcing in Asia. So we worked together with the postal companies. So with the Swiss Post, Dutch Post from the Netherlands, and many other postal companies, and we provided services. So they opened big data centers, and they opened like big offices with 500 people. And what these 500 people did was just sit in front of the computer, type things, or do some services for Europeans, or even like for anywhere on the planet. And that was possible through the internet. So, the question was, how then could they solve all these problems? Like, how could they then actually make all this happen, communicate with each other, move the software from one place to the other? You know, it was always a big topic, copyright. Yeah? Like copyright, copy songs, copy software, copy all these things. And then we had this initiative of Europe, like bringing companies together under the idea of open source, free and open source software. So that was an opportunity for me personally. We started a company, and it was real fun. We had a lot of people working with us, and we did a lot of interesting things. We also started an open source hotel in Vietnam, and so on. So that was the beginning. And then, though, we said we feel we don't connect regularly with people. Right? I mean, this is also sometimes what people told me here in Thailand. There's always the international community. You see all these news on Hacker News, like some cool AI stuff being developed somewhere. And I felt when I was in Vietnam, I don't connect with the international community. I always connect with businesses and so on, but I feel like a bit left out when it's about the latest technologies. Because when I'm in Berlin, I'm from Germany, from Berlin originally, I go to Berlin, and I just go to Hackerspace or to some event, and I meet some guy, and he will tell me the latest thing. And maybe I will only read this on Hacker News 2 or 3 months later. So this is really the advantage of being here at an event. You guys are now here, and I already met a lot of people who are really into tech, and I met many young people from Thailand who really are have the energy to learn more. So, right, we don't only connect on the internet, it's always good to meet. Yeah. So later on, we'll also have a panel here discussing a bit like how we can collaborate with Thailand. And I want to show you a few more slides. So FOSS Asia, we do a lot of things. Originally, we organize events to connect people from all over the world and learn about technologies. But then what happens at events, people have ideas. They say, hey, why don't we do this? Or I have this problem. And somebody says, yes, I'm working on something. So people start to work together. And this is how our projects started. We met at events, we met at FOSS Asia summits, and we started software projects. Later on, people had the idea, let's do hardware as well. So we actually do hardware projects as well. For example, I can show you one hardware project that we are doing is the Pocket Science Lab here that we're doing, or SUSE AI. There will be talks about this later. I will hand this around. This is, for example, hardware that we produce. There's also a mobile app online. Yeah, you can just hand it around. People can have a look, and they can scan the QR code and find every layer is free and open. It means the hardware, we also have open schematics. People ask, how can I make money with hardware? Well, it's very easy. You just produce it and sell it, right? So actually, it's even easier than software. So we do a lot of different things. We are making FOSS and open tech become true. Not only talking about it, we do it. So many events in 2009, we connect with the GNOME community. We have regional events. We connect with developers in India. We heard everywhere in the world, actually, in Asia, but also like even in the US and so on. We built a very active developer community. So we have 4,000 people registered on our GitHub channel. So you can go to GitHub, you can see there is a pull request merged every 15 minutes on average. So what we want to do in future, of course, not just being fast and always merge things fast and get more people on board, also more quality, of course. This is what is possible with open source. And I said, hardware. Mr. Wietert is here. Mr. Wietert? It's just all the moment he's helping us here with a stage. Mr. Wietert Jung, for example, he's from Singapore. And this is the great thing about Asia. People always speak many different languages. So for us, it's always a challenge to work with China, for example. But a lot of the production takes place in China, a lot of schematics for hardware. So Singaporeans, many speak Chinese. So that was great. He helped us really to get things working because producing hardware is a big risk. It could cost a lot of money. Next project we're doing is also regarding to neural labs here, to neuroscience. We are collecting neural waves, our neural lab hardware, which is there to collect brain waves. Of course, it will also be free and open. It's under heavy development at the moment. So pretty cool thing. Then we have, we had the question, how can we actually collaborate? Because are there any from India here? From India? Any people from India? Yeah, I see. Yeah, a few people from India. So we have a lot of developers from India, and there's a lot of communication. But India has so many people. Just so many people. How many now? Like 1 point something billion, right? So so the question is, how can we get more and more people on board? So the world is so big, so we also have to solve a lot of problems. We need it. We need to collaborate. So we defined our best practices, and this was done together with Niranjan, who is a developer from India, and because like most of the questions always come from India. Yeah. Then, of course, we do partnerships, like with the UNESCO, with other organizations like Google. We have our Pocket Science Lab. I just give it a round. We have the SUSY AI project. You can talk to us. We have the booth on the 10th floor. It's the alternative to Google Home and Alexa. I don't have enough time to go too much into detail, but there's a chance at this event to learn about our free and open projects and also use them commercially. So coding programs, for example, this is another thing that we found out is very successful. So I have a question here. How many people have coded before or are coding or are developers here in the room? How many people are developers? Yeah. So just raise your arm very high. Don't be shy. Yeah. So looks like quite a lot. I can't say, like maybe 60, 70%, something like that. So that's pretty cool. So we want to connect with you guys more. We have a lot of repositories online, but even if you say, oh, well, there's no project for me, we would love to connect you with other friends that we have in the community. It's not just always one project. For example, we have a project that uses Flask, and we, if anyone contributes to Flask, we always profit. So this would be really great to connect here with you guys and work together. And then we're doing the FOSS Asia Academy. Marco will talk a little bit more about it. So my message is this: open tech is here. It's here today. It's successful. It solves people's problems. It's growing, and we are doing it. So let's continue to make FOSS in Asia and open tech around the world a reality. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mario. Thank you very much.